Welcome to the studio of NIOS. Today, we will be discussing about financial sources of income for funding schools in India. Let us begin with various types of resources required for the management of a school. We know that we need different varieties of resources for running a school in our society. We can classify all these resources under three main headings. They are human resources, then second, material resources, and in third, financial resources. All kinds of resources which we need for running a school can be put under these three main headings. There are different types of resources which we have discussed: human resource, material resource, and financial resources, which we will see in detail now. Human resources are the people who make up the workforce of an organization, education sector, business sector, economy, etc. In case of education or in school, human resource involve teachers, principal, office staff, supporting staff, and so on. Without this human resource, it is impossible for us to run or to manage a school. Material resources. Let us look into what is material resources. Material resources are assets in the form of material possessions. For example, in a school, bench, desk, infrastructure in schools, books, textbooks, reference materials, library, computer, all these kind of materials can be considered as material resources which are essential for the functioning of a school. Third category is financial resources. All the goods and services so produced and then converted into money form can be defined as financial resources. Financial resources. Let us define financial resources. All goods and services so produced and then converted into money form can be called as financial resources. All school programs, including teaching and organization of school activities, require not only efficient management, but at the same time, we need a good financial support as well. And this financial resources has to be properly managed with a proper budget, efficient use of funds to achieve desired results. Without having a proper budget and efficient and effective use of the fund available for a school, the financial resources will go futile. So we need a proper budgeting and efficient use of funds available for the effective financial resource management. For ensuring adequate and timely availability of funds, financial resources should be adequate. So, adequate financial resources is an inevitable condition for the running of any school. As we know, to run a school, we need money for many purposes, for giving salary to the teachers, for buying books and other library resources, for providing midday meal program, we need financial support. For providing chalks and other educational support to the teachers, we need financial support. And for providing basic essential equipments which are available, which are necessary for a lab, we need financial resources, and so on. Financial sources of income for funding a school is an important issue that we have to discuss in this particular module. In a country like India, major financial sources of income come from government. The government mainly includes central government, state government, local self-government, and other governmental agencies who are included and supporting the cost of education. So, in India, a major educational support in terms of financial funding, in terms of funding to a school, comes from governments, various governments which we have discussed, central, state, local bodies, and other governmental agencies. To run the educational institutions, Both central and state government provide immense financial support to our education system. Government institutions are funded and controlled by the government. So in this way, when we look at various types of institutions in our country, we can see that there are government institutions and government-aided institutions and self-financing institutions. Government institutions are fully funded by government. Salary of the teachers and all expenditure needed for the running of the school is being provided by the government. Now, another category is government-aided educational institutions. So, government-aided educational institutions are provided grant-in aid as per grant-in aid rules. This means that the institution will be managed by a private agency. But the salary for the teachers and non-teaching staffs and other maintenance, etc., will be provided by the government. But at the same time, depending upon the grant-in aid rules prevailing in various state governments, appointment of the teachers will be sometimes the prerogative of the management. Or depending upon the grant-in aid rules, rules will be different in different states. Anyway, government-aided schools also receive a good amount of support from governments, both central and state governments. Third category is the self-financing institutions. Self-financing institutions or self-financing schools are established and run by private bodies or private organizations, or it can be various trusts or societies, or it can be even a business house or a business organization. They don't receive any kind of financial support from the government. Instead, they charge fee from the students and they use that money for managing the institution. Let us look into local bodies and their role in education. Local bodies include municipal boards, committees in urban areas, etc. And then Zilla Board, Parishad for rural areas, village panchayat in a village are the examples of local bodies. These local bodies provide extensive support for the schools which are located in and around their jurisdiction. Their support can be in the form of financial support and in the form of other academic supports and providing various infrastructural supports, etc. There are many other agencies who are involved in supporting education other than central government, state government and local government bodies. Central government and state government cannot meet the whole demand of education facilities in large scale cities and in towns. In such cases, the government seeks finance from other agencies or funding from other agencies. In recent years, private bodies or private organizations, trusts, societies, business organizations, and even external agencies like World Bank have been helping our nation for establishing primary and upper primary schools. When we go to a city or an urban area, we can see that most of the education institutions in urban society or in urban sector are being private education institutions. Because of the reason that urban sectors are constituted by business people and people who can afford to pay for education, private educational institutions has mushroomed in the areas of urban sector. There are certain voluntary contributions made to schools from various community, from various sections of community. Let us look into what are the voluntary contributions given to the schools from various sections of the community. It can include in the form of free labor for constructing buildings. In certain cases, we can see that certain community members or maybe societies or charitable societies or philanthropic people or agencies who are engaged in philanthropic work provided free labor for construction of building for a school. Certain cases we can see that contribution in the form of in the material form, like providing computers to the schools, providing free books to the schools, providing free textbooks to the schools. And in some cases we can see that certain organizations provide money to the schools. For example, alumni associations of different societies, of different schools, will, if the Alumni Association is a strong organization, Alumni Association provide financial support for the upliftment of a school. Free land also been provided to schools by different community members and different agencies who are non-profit in their nature. So we have seen that free labor, free contribution of material, free money, funding, and free land, etc. are given to our schools for its smooth functioning by the various sections of our community. Dharmashalas, Panchayat Ghar, religious places like temples, mosque, gurudwara, church, schools, dispensaries, etc. provide financial supports to poor schools or maybe the schools which are located in an area which needs real financial support. Endowment is another important component for improving and for supporting education in our country. By endowment, it means that a corpus fund endowed by an individual or a family or a trust or a society for a special purpose or general purpose. Say, for example, if an individual wanted to institute an endowment in the memory of his parents or maybe his relatives, he put up a corpus fund in the form of money to the bank, and the interest of this money will be used as an endowment for the children who studies in that particular schools, or maybe for whatever the purpose this endowment is needed, is intended for. The idea behind such endowment is charity to an institution for a good social cause. In India, the endowment funds are being used as a source of income for promoting financial support to the schools. But it has to be said that endowment as a good source of income is still to be probed in India. Savings is another important option for supporting our education system. Savings means that the surplus of income after meeting expenditure over a particular heads of expenditure. So different schools will have savings after meeting its expenditure. And this savings and its interest also can become a source of income for the schools. In a school system, funds are received as block grant, large amount of grant, from time to time, whereas expenditure is incurred when the activity or program is organized. For example, a school gets a large amount of money for conducting its educational tour at the start of the year. The school will not spend this entire amount within 1 month of starting of the school year. Instead, this money will be utilized only at the time when the school decides to go for a field trip or so on. So the time in between the grant of fund and the utilization of fund will bring certain income in the form of interest to the schools. So this interest also will form as a financial source for various schools. Funds received as block grant is deposited in post office usually, or in bank, or interest earned or savings occur due to surplus fund may be used by the school for meeting its various needs. This may help the educational institutions to meet other miscellaneous expenditure. And one should note that this expenditure of the income which is accrued from the interest of the block grant can be spent only in accordance with the rules and regulations of the government. This is a very important thing which we have to notice. Another important source of income for a school or financing our education system is examination fees and other various fees as part of education. Primary or upper primary schools run by the government do not charge any fee from the students. Absolutely free education is provided to the students who are studying in government institutions. But government-aided institutions, on the other hand, or private unaided institutions, self-financing institutions, charge different type of fees from the students. The fees and other charges, the fees charged by the grant-aid institutions or private-aid institutions and self-financing institutions include tuition fees, examination fees, computer fees, pupils fund, and so on. Various types of fees are being charged by the private aided institutions and unaided institutions. Let us conclude. We have seen that there are various types of resources for the management of a school or an educational institution. These resources include human resources, material resources, financial resources. We have seen what are the various human resources, material resources, and financial resources. I am sure that now you will be bring up with new examples for human, material, and financial resources. Under financial resources, we also learned that the different types of income which a school generate out of various sources, which we have seen that the schools generate income from governments, central government, state government, and local agencies, and other voluntary organizations which are working as part of the community, and from other individuals from the community, and other income which a school earn through the savings savings and its interest which the schools get as a result of its block grant, and so on. So we have seen that the financial sources of income for a school is manifold, and still various agencies are not being explored by our Indian school system has to be further been explored. With this, we conclude this session. I thank you all.